doubt that Jesus could come back at any moment to take us up. He who did that, who began a good work in you, will bring it to completion at the day of Christ Jesus. When we think of the second coming of our Lord Jesus Christ to this earth, only the Father knows. Only the Father knows when Jesus will return. So we read in Matthew 24 and verse 36, these words of Jesus himself. Concerning that day and hour, no one knows, not even the angels of heaven, nor the Son, but the Father only. And I have heard the argument, as I'm sure you have, that, well, that was Jesus in his humanity, as a man upon the earth, not knowing when his return would be. But now he's ascended, he's in glory with the Father. Surely he knows. Well, I don't know about that. I'm just going to hold to what Jesus himself said in his word that stands for all generations. No one knows, not even the angels of heaven, nor the Son, but the Father only. Point number two, when Jesus comes, every eye shall see him. In Matthew 24, verse 27, and there's a comparison there, Revelation 1, verse 7, we read these words, for as the lightning comes from the east and shines as far as the west, so will be the coming of the Son of Man. When Jesus comes again, it is not going to be in silence, in quietness, in some backwater place like Bethlehem where he came to the first time. God incarnate, born as a baby in that manger, or laid in the manger by Mary, his mother. No, when the Lord returns to this earth, every eye, and for me, that means every eye, shall see him. Whether he comes at night or whether he comes in the daytime, every eye shall see him. Matthew 23, verse 39. Again, the words of our Lord. For I tell you, you will not see me again, Jerusalem, until you say, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hallelujah, praise the Lord for words like until, as my pastor has always taught us over the years. For when you see an until, you know that something is not complete. Something isn't finished. And God has unfinished business with his people Israel, with the tribe of Judah, with the city of Jerusalem, and with, as we'll see later on, the Temple Mount area. Say, well, in his second letter, and these are just a few verses that are passages that I'm picking out for you and for us to look at today. And we have something more sure, Peter says, the prophetic word, referring to the Bible, the scripture, the canon, to which you will do well to pay attention until the day dawns and the morning star rises in your heart. Again, the day. No mention of the earth, Jerusalem, Israel, Temple Mount, Mount of Olives, Antichrist, Armageddon. There's no mention of these things. The church is being spoken to once again about this day. And we will do well to pay attention, Peter says, to the prophetic word, the sure word of prophecy, until that day dawns and the morning star rises in our hearts. What a wonderful statement that is. Something is going to take place within us on that day. We're going to come into the fullness of our salvation. These bodies are going to be redeemed. Our souls have been redeemed. Our spirits have been made alive. They've been quickened. But our bodies are still decaying. And as we'll see later on, flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of heaven. We've got to be changed. Something has got to happen to us and in us so that we can come into the fullness of what our Lord Jesus Christ did 2,000 years ago on the cross of Calvary. So what day were the apostles referring to? I believe this is the day of our being gathered to meet the Lord Jesus in the air. The day when the church, or the true church, those who are truly born again, born of the Holy Spirit, Bible-believing, Spirit-filled Christians, the day when they, when we, I trust that applies to every one of us here this afternoon, when we are caught up and raptured to be with the Lord. 1 Thessalonians 4, let's turn there, and verses 13 to 18. And this, if you like, is the clearest rapture passage that we have in Scripture. What we're doing today is not trying to proof text the rapture. We're trying to bring the whole counsel of God as best we can in this limited time that we have, just to look at what the whole Scriptures say about this rapture of the church. And in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4 and verse 13, we'll read it together. Paul begins, "Brothers, we do not want you to be ignorant." That's how one translation begins. My translation says this, "But we do not want you to be uninformed, brothers, about those who are asleep." Not those that are having a doze, but those who are dead in Christ. Those who are in the grave, whose bodies have died, but they died believing in and trusting in the Lord Jesus Christ as their Lord and their Savior and their Redeemer. We don't want you to be uninformed about them, that you may not grieve as others do who have no hope. Now, we're in Thessaloniki here. We're in northern Greece, the region of Macedonia. And you may know this, that on many gravestones in that area were written in Greek the words, "no hope." Because that was the Greek philosophy. You're here once, eat, live, drink, be merry, for tomorrow you die and that's it. There's nothing beyond the grave. That was the Greek mindset, by and large, the Greek philosophy of the age. What a tragic thing that people would go to the grave without any hope. And so many today have no hope. They believe this is it, that we evolved, that we're here by some cosmic accident, and we only live once, and we better make the best use of our life, because that's it, there's nothing beyond. Paul says, we are not like those who have no hope. We have a hope. That hope is found in Christ Jesus, our Lord, who died and on the third day rose again, and 40 days later ascended back to the Father, and 10 days after that sent the Holy Spirit to indwell those that would come to him. Anybody heard or had this statement said to them? "But the word rapture isn't even in the Bible." Well, nobody's ever said it directly to me, but I have heard people or read in books that Christians, even Christian ministers, Christian leaders, theologians have said this. As if that means, well, this isn't a true doctrine, the doctrine of the rapture, of being caught up to be with the Lord in the air. The immediate reply we can give is, neither is the word Trinity. Can you find the word Trinity in your Bible? It doesn't matter whether you're reading from the King James, the New King James, the American Standard, the New American Standard, the Revised Standard Version, the English Standard Version, the New International Version, whatever translation you have, and there are not many good ones after that, you cannot find the word Trinity, because it comes from a Latin word, Trinitas, a theological word that was created by a man who lived many generations ago called Tertullian. It's called a Latin, or one of the fathers of the Latin Church, a theologian of the early days of the church after the time of the apostles. He came up with the word Trinitas to describe God as Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. One God, three persons. And our English translation of Trinitas is Trinity. There's a tri-unity within the Godhead. But you won't find the word in the Bible, but what that word means is in the Bible, isn't it? If you take the doctrine of the Trinity out of the Bible, what have you got? You've got the Bible of the Jehovah's Witnesses. You've got the Bible of the Christadelphians. You've got the Bible of the Mormons and all these other cults and sects that don't believe that God is Father and Son and Holy Spirit. Take the Trinity, or the doctrine of the Trinity, out of the Bible, and the Bible falls apart. So we don't need a particular word to be there on the page in front of us in English for the doctrine that's caught up in that word to be biblical, to be in the Scripture. But you know, we're I won't put it that way. I was going to say on more solid ground when we come to the rapture. Let's just put it this way. The word rapture isn't in the Bible, so people say. It all depends on which translation of the Bible you are using. So hands up, those of you here today that are reading from a German translation of the Bible. Anybody here reading from a Spanish translation of the Bible? Or a Hungarian version or a Russian version of the Bible? Anybody? No? Anybody got the original Bible that was written in Hebrew, the Old Testament, and in Greek, the New Testament? No, we don't have the original manuscripts in Hebrew and Greek before us today. I think you've all come with an English Bible. Yep. It's a translation, isn't it? It is not the original Bible. God gave what we call the Old Testament to his people in the Hebrew language with a bit of Aramaic and a couple of other languages in there. And we've been given the New Testament through the inspiration of the Holy Spirit in Greek. But because we live in England or Britain, we've had it translated for us into English. And we thank the Lord for men like William Tyndale, who I mentioned a few moments ago, who at the cost of his life gave us the Bible in our common language so that we could understand the Word of God. But before men like William Tyndale came along, the Bible was in what language in this country for 1,000 years? That's right. We're going to come to that in a moment. The original Greek, in this verse that we have read, 1 Thessalonians 4, verse 17, let's remind ourselves again, we who are alive, who are left, will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. The Greek word for caught up is harpazo. Can you say harpazo? Very good. The Lord himself, he always sets the example. He's the first to die, to lay down his life. And all who follow him are called to do the same, to take up our cross and follow. He's the first to rise. He's the first fruits from the dead. And you and I one day, as we read from 1 Thessalonians 4, many other places, we too will be resurrected. And he was raptured. And so we too will be raptured, caught up in the clouds, taken up from one place to another to be with him in the air. Something dramatic and sudden is about to happen to us too. In a far more profound way, I would suggest, than happened to Enoch, or to Elijah, or to Philip, or even to the Apostle Paul. And it has to happen to us, the church, those believers in our Lord Jesus Christ, so that we can inherit the kingdom of God. As Paul says in 1 Corinthians 15, we mentioned it before in verse 50. I tell you this, brothers, flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does the perishable inherit the imperishable. We have to be changed. We have to be fitted for glory. Now, you're not going to get a brand new body in the sense of a different body. Your body is going to be transformed. It's going to be renewed. It's going to be glorified. It's going to be changed. And in that sense, we're going to have a new body like our Lord's glorious body. And that will be the means by which we can be caught up and raptured to be with the Lord in the air. The thought that Jesus could come back at any moment to take us up. He did that. Who began a good work in you will bring it to completion at the day of Christ Jesus.